or flip and writes, a branch in the board gaming genre that had a recent popularity boom. The concept is very simple. You either roll dice or flip cards, then you write on your player sheet something to do with the revealed information. Most, if not all, games in this genre are relatively short to medium length, making it very accessible to newer players. I'll be honest, the first time I heard of this genre, I was super skeptical. I basically scoffed at the idea of roll and writes. I thought it was just super lame, but one game opened my eyes to how wonderful it could be. Enter Cartographers. In Cartographers, you are tasked to draw a map, and if your map scores the most points, you'll win the game. Each turn, a card is revealed. The card tells you information about the shape and terrain type that you have to draw on your map. Imagine Tetris, right? But instead of shapes falling from the top, you get to place the shapes wherever you want. You always have to draw one shape and one terrain from each card. But if you noticed, the cards always have more than one of either the shape or terrain, which means you get a choice. For example, in this homestead card, you must draw the only shape given to you, which is that T-shape in Tetris. But you get a choice between houses or farmlands as the terrain. Whereas if you look at the Great River card, you are stuck with the water terrain, but you get a choice of either the three squares and getting a coin or the bigger shape. You can also rotate these shapes around just like Tetris, but unlike Tetris, you could mirror the shapes as well. If you reveal a ruins card, the next card revealed must be drawn on the ruins. Each round, you'll flip these cards and draw on your map until the sum of the cards' time counter reaches or exceeds the round's time counter limit. There are 5 terrain types in the game: houses, woods, farmland, water, and monsters. How each terrain scores depends on the scoring method you decide to play with in each game. I'll set an example for an easy beginner game. So you got Sentinel Wood on A, where you score 1 point for each forest square next to the edge of the map. Mage's Valley on B, where you get 2 points for each water square next to a mountain, or 1 point for each farmland square next to a mountain. Wild Holds on C, where you get 8 points per cluster of 6 or more houses. And finally, Borderlands on D, where you get 6 points per row and column of the map that you completely filled. In other words, bingos. These scoring methods are very self-explanatory, but they are all not scored at the same time. At the end of each round, only 2 cards out of the 4 are scored. The round cards will tell you which cards will get scored at the end of that round. So round 1 or Spring, you'll score A and B. Round 2 or Summer scores B and C. Round 3 or Fall will score C and D. And lastly, round 4 or Winter will score D and E. The scoring section of your sheet will also tell you which cards are scored at the end of that round. You will also score 1 point for each coin that you have collected so far at the end of each round. You could get coins by selecting the smaller shape in some of the cards, or by surrounding the adjacent free spaces of the mountains in your map. By the way, these mountains are already counted as filled, so you can never draw on them. Then there are these monsters, which is by far my favorite thing about the game. A monster card is introduced into the deck of cards that you will reveal from each round. When it gets revealed, you have to pass your map to the person next to you, depending on which way the monster card says, and you have to then draw the depicted monster shape on your friend's map before you return the maps back to them. Then that particular monster card is taken out of the game completely. For each empty space adjacent to the monster, you will get -1, so you want to surround those monsters. And obviously you want to put the monsters where it will generate the most negative points for the other players. And I just told you all you needed to know to play the game. As you could tell from the video title, Cartographers is my number one base board game of all time. It's simple, easy to learn and teach, and most importantly, is able to fit technically any number of players. A lot of games become awful to play as you get closer to its maximum number of players, but that doesn't happen in Cartographers. Not a lot of games can pull that off. It's the perfect gateway game that will also appeal to veteran gamers. It is highly replayable as well due to the numerous combinations of scoring methods and double-sided map. The monster cards, again the best thing ever, helps introduce some player interaction that is not overbearing. This is much needed in roll and write games like this, as they tend to be more solitaire than any other genre. Sabotaging your friend's map is also fun as hell. If you watched my previous video, I liked Azul for its hate drafting. This definitely has the same fun feel to it. I really cannot think of a downside for this game. If anything, the shit can actually run out, I suppose, but you could just laminate them and use markers to play instead of the pencils. This is definitely the most bang for buck game I've ever purchased, since I almost ran out of those blank sheets. And finally, as with my other videos, it's time to compare Cartographers to other games in the same genre that I've played. First, we got Silver and Gold. It's basically an even simpler version of Cartographers. To me, the game just feels way too similar, so honestly there's no room for both in my collection. I sold Silver and Gold right after my first play because it's just way too simple and dumbed down. Plus, it could only fit 4 players despite the flip and write nature of the game. There's honestly no real reason to get this one over Cartographers in my opinion. Next, we have Welcome To, another flip and write game about building your own neighborhood. It's kinda puzzlier than Cartographers, but a different type of puzzle because it has got a numerical and spatial puzzle element to it, unlike Cartographers, which is just purely spatial. This is my second best flip and write game. It can fit any number of players just like Cartographers, though not as newbie friendly in my opinion, but definitely a gateway game still. It doesn't have much player interaction other than competing to get those achievement cards' bigger points, but I would really still recommend this to anyone just like Cartographers. Then we have Railroad Inc. Red Edition. It's a route building roll and write where you are trying to basically create these huge interconnecting railroad connections. It's a spatial puzzle, but it's more like a path building one. You roll 4 dice each round and draw the 4 resulting faces on the board. It's a much simpler and shorter game, but it's completely solitaire. The game could actually be a bit puzzlier than Cartographers, despite it being a bit simpler. I am not much of a big fan of the expansion dice, and the game only fits 6 players per copy. I would still recommend this game though, I enjoyed the puzzle quite a bit. Up next, we have Kokoro, Avenue of Kodama. This game has a similar route building feel to Railroad Inc., but feels a lot more unpolished compared to Railroad Inc. Kokoro has a heavy push-your-luck aspect to it, as it's very swingy, which makes it unapologetically brutal at times. The game could fit 8 players, which is more than Railroad Inc., and has more fun factor compared to Railroad Inc., but it's not as satisfying of a brain burner. I wouldn't recommend this game, as Railroad Inc. feels like an all-around upgrade of this game. And lastly, we have Lanterns Dice, a roll-and-write game based on one of my favorite Tile Lane game, Lanterns. The best thing about this game is that everyone gets different things every turn, as opposed to most flip or roll and writes. They borrowed one mechanism from the original game and implemented it quite nicely. It's a pretty good roll and write, though there's nothing groundbreaking about it. Simple spatial puzzle and a short game, but sadly only fits 4 people. I would recommend this game as well. A bit more than Railroad Inc. because it has more player interaction. And that's all for this video, folks. Hope you enjoyed it, and please leave a comment on what you think, whether you agree or disagree, or perhaps recommend me some other flip or roll and write games.